that point.
So, you might have noticed, if you book your tickets online or anywhere, that it was a night branded as Meet the Other Folk. Now, I'm aware this is a dangerous way to go on the night of Samhain, when the veil is thin. But, I have my iron handy. We have barred the doors, and we are among good company. Fortunately, Jez isn't here because they've got loads of good fairy stories in Wales.
Mm. It's probably something to do with having very, very good beer and a long way between the pub and home.
I think Jez is here. I think he's lurking outside, hating the sound of human happiness.
Grendel, in your
gongong
jazz.
So
who's going to volunteer to sit up all night?
I don't know. Who has the strength of 30 men in their arms? Anyone?
Well, yeah,
certainly not bloody me at the minute.
Bloody modern people, eh? Honestly, weak, growing.
I was going to say, if 30 of us grab him at the same time and pull, though, we should be fine.
Are there 30 of us?
24.
24. Oh, not quite enough. They're close enough.
Ooh.
No, actually, as it turns out, Nick is leatherwork. That's what really does it.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Oh,
or burn it in the oven.
No, sorry, that possibly was a bit below. Sorry, Jez. However, as I mentioned, it is a long walk from the pub back home in Wales, which possibly brings us to a good time for a story of Welsh origin from some near a cave complex in the Brecons. There stands a farm called Penfata. Ooh, no, I tell you what, we'll do that one later, actually. That's a much longer story, and I wouldn't want to bore you with it now. You have to be pissed for that one. Two young men are walking home from work, cutting peat sods up on the hill. Not them, the pits they're cutting out the ground. They came into a wood. Rhys and Llewellyn, two very good friends. They've worked together for many years. They knew each other very well. They'd shared pallets in the same hay lot. They knew each other probably better than anybody in here knows any other person. On the way home one night, Rhys suddenly stops and says, "What is that incredible music I hear drifting through the trees?" Llewellyn could hear nothing and looked at him slightly put out and said, "Are you mad?" But, "No, I have heard this tune 100 times before and it is my favourite and I have to go and dance. Just one dance. I have to away." And he disappeared into the woods. Well, like I say, Llewellyn knew him well and assumed this was just an elaborate ruse to away to the alehouse for sup and wenches. So Llewellyn continued back to the farm. Down he sat, ate his supper, up to bed and into his pallet, without seeing hide nor hair of Rhys and thinking nothing of it. Waking in the night, looking across and finding Rhys's pallet unused, again thinking nothing of it, because it was well known that after he'd had a few drinks, he was known to go a-wooing of late and not return until the wee small hours in time for work. When Llewellyn awoke in the morning and the pallet was still unslept in, this began to arouse an unusual feeling of worry for his good friend. Breakfast eaten, still no sign. To work, stood on the farmyard, master in front. Still no sign. Now he starts to think his mate's had a bit of a session and has woken up in someone's house that he doesn't know the way out of, or similar, and he'd be there soon. So he held his tongue. But there was heavy work to be done that day. All the sods cut the day before had to be carried from the mountainside down to the farm and stacked to dry. Back-breaking work. One man absent at the start was sorely missed. And as they were walking up to the peat field, the master beckons and says, trying. Come here, lad. In a Welsh accent, obviously. I can't do a Welsh accent, so I won't upset you by trying. Come here, lad. Tell me, do you know where Rhys is? I said, well, Master, I don't. We were walking home through the woods last night, and he said he heard music, and off he walked. Haven't seen him since. Thought the Master, knowing all too well Rhys's habits as well, thinking maybe he'd had a hard one, and he'd turn up by lunchtime. Noontide came and went. No Rhys. The Master now thought it pertinent to possibly quiz his worker a little further as to where his absent farmhand was. Said Llewellyn, I'd come here and sit down and tell me exactly what happened last night. Well, he said he heard music through the trees and made up some guff and disappeared off, I assume, to the alehouse. And he said, have you seen him since? No, my lord, I haven't. Right, we'll send a runner to the pub. Go and make sure he's there. They didn't have telephones in those days, they had to send a runner. Rings the pub all the time when I'm down there, make sure I'm doing what I'm supposed to. Had to send a runner. Well, the runner returned with news, absent of Rhys. Was he at the pub at all last night? Says the Master. Nope. They've not seen him for nigh on 3 days, and his tab stands high, so they would have known if he was there. Thinks the Master, and sits down once more with Llewellyn and says, come here, boy, and tell me exactly what happened last night. Llewellyn recounted the tale of the walk home, the strange moment that Rhys disappeared, waiting for him for a couple of minutes, realising he wasn't coming back and returning to his bed. Well, a man absent for the best part of a day. No witnesses. It began to grow in the farm owner's mind that murder may be afoot. And that on the walk back from the field, Rhys and Llewellyn had quarrelled, slightly, and it had got out of hand, and Llewellyn had taken it upon himself to commit murder, and had hidden the body somewhere, and the farm owner made as much noise to the local magistrate, who took it very seriously, and threw Llewellyn in the deepest, darkest corner of their small jail. And questioned him thoroughly on this and came to the same assumption that murder most foul must have been done. And so they sent out search parties. Found nothing. Llewellyn found himself imprisoned until the body was found. Protest as hard as he might that he'd only seen his friend run into the woods and had no reason to quarrel with the man. No reason to fight, certainly no reason to kill him. They would not believe a word of it. And they left him locked in that dungeon for a year, believing the body would eventually turn up. Not quite understanding medical science and the degradation of the body, but a year to the day, exactly, a tinker came to town the night of. The tinker was wise in the ways of the other folk. And he suggested that on the night following, it might be worth assembling a party of fellows and heading out from the town with Llewellyn to the point where he had last seen Rhys, in case another kind of foul play had trodden the boards that night. Well, the following night, 1 year and 1 day from Rhys's disappearance, the company of fellows assembled at the pub and wandered out into the hills with Llewellyn dragging feet chains, hands bound, to a point. And Llewellyn stopped and he said, yep. Yeah, this is it. This is the last place I saw my friend Rhys. I went, I'll just have a quick check, but I'm almost certain this is exactly the spot I was stood. And to pace forwards. hear music, said he, terrified to his very soul. But the music was so beautiful, he wanted to move on. The tinker, being a wise man and knowing in the ways of the fae, put his foot next to Llewellyn's. Then, ah, I too hear sweet music and am moved to dance, but I will not, because I know that is how they bind you. Look carefully about our feet. And the band of fellows pulled back the grass and discovered, growing proud, a small stand of white mushrooms that you may well know as a fairy ring. Well, they grow in the same place year on year on year. Llewellyn, foot in circle. Tinker, foot in circle. Had not paced forwards and were not taken by the fae, but could see suddenly coming through the trees towards them a swirling, spiralling procession of dancers, footing it with the best of them. In the centre was friend Rhys, still in the same clothes he disappeared a year and a day ago. As he came whirling by, the tinker stepped back and braced hard against Llewellyn. Llewellyn reached out, grabbed him by the shoulder and dragged him in. Rhys was dazzled. Rabbit in headlights, properly didn't have a clue where he was. And his gaze settled on his friend, Llewellyn, and it began to prickle at the back of his mind. And he said, oh, don't take me now. Let me stay for one more dance. Just one. I've only been there 5 minutes. Llewellyn grabbed him by the collar and said, 5 minutes, you idiot! You've been there a year and a day! You've had me up for murder. Now, you're coming back to the town to answer for your actions and for your conduct and get me out of the clinker. No questions asked.
Turns out,
Llewellyn might not quite have been right when he said no questions asked, because the whole village wanted to know where this man had been. So many questions asked. But all that Rhys could ever say, as he'd been dancing for 5 minutes, he had paused for neither food nor drink, nor sleep. If you find yourself 1 foot in a fairy ring and hearing sweet music drifting on the winds, I urge you, take a second to consider. Because if no one knows you're gone, they may never find you again.